service this morning. Brandon and Hunter were baptized this morning. And for those of you that were here this morning, I had asked if anybody else wanted to be baptized. And Belinda was here with her three grandchildren. And they wanted to talk to me after service. So I went in and counseled with them, Belinda and I, all three of them. They're 11, 9, and 8 was their ages, Elijah, Anthony, and Ella. And so anyway, after counseling with them, and they wanted to be baptized, and I said, well, you know, you need to be saved first. And they said, yeah, we know, that's why we're here. And so they knew more than I did. But anyway, they all prayed and asked the Lord to save them. So all three of them got saved this morning. And we were in the middle of that, and here come another little boy. My best little buddy, Kyron. He comes busting in the door, and he said, I need to be saved. And so he prayed and asked God to save him. And I asked him, what about baptism tonight? He said, tonight. We're going to do it tonight. I said, okay. So he's here and ready to go. So that's great. Also this morning, I'll be sharing a little bit of that at message tonight, but I got word. They called me, Josie called me, at Jackson Chapel. Of course, I told you four got saved over there this week. And they had their altar call this morning, and they had not four, but six come for baptism this morning. So God is good. Also, I had lunch today, and I met with a group of kids that I took to camp 20 years ago. Yeah, they're all married, all got their own kids. As a matter of fact, those same kids were there eating, and after I told them, they already knew that I'd been to camp with them, and because they'd done heard all about it. And anyway, one of the girls called her son, who is 8 years old, and said, come here. His name was Liam, and said, tell Brother Vicky what happened to you today. And Liam got saved this morning over at Eden. And so I'm seeing the children of the kids that I took to camp 20 years ago. I'm seeing their kids getting saved now. Folks, that's a blessing. So continue to pray. Listen, God's not done yet. He's still working, and I expect him to do more. We've got three baptisms. We've got this one tonight here. And we've got three already set up in jail tonight after this service. And hopefully, before it's over, usually when I go up there with three, we end up with six. So we'll see what happens there. Listen, God is doing some amazing things, folks. Don't ever feel defeated. Don't ever feel like you're done. I'm going to preach this message tonight. Just sling another rock. All right. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We love you. Lord, you're so amazing, God, what you do. I thank you, Lord, for those that were baptized this morning, those that were saved today. Lord, I pray your richest blessings upon their life. God, as they live their life out, God, may they be faithful to you. Lord, serve you with all their heart. Not let the devil deter them in any way, God, that they may stay focused and fixed on the cross of Christ. Thank you, Jesus, for what you're doing in this part of the country. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good evening, church. Good to see all of you this evening. I hope you've enjoyed this beautiful day the Lord blessed us with. And hope you come here to praise tonight. We are going to start off tonight with Lead On Good Shepherd. Amen. Alan, let's just make that other one for when we do baptism, we'll do it then.
Have you ever felt like you were just facing a big giant and you didn't know what to do? Many people who can identify with this, and it's not all the time about addiction and alcoholism, but many people that have faced that, that's one of the biggest giants you'll ever face in your life. I know I faced it, many of you have faced it, and it's not easy. But if we would learn from the Bible, what the Bible tells us, we learn how to overcome those giants in our life. And I want to read from the story of that tonight out of 1 Samuel chapter 17, where David faces the giant of his life. 1 Samuel 17. I want to read out of, let's start at 32. Verse 32, 1 Samuel 17. Oh, if you're there, there you go. And David said to Saul, "Let no man's heart be failed because of him. Thy servant will go and fight with this Philistine." And Saul said to David, "Thou art not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for thou art but a youth, and he's a man of war from his youth." And David said to Saul, "Thy servant kept his father's sheep, and there came a lion and a bear and took a lamb out of the flock. And I went out after him and smote him and delivered it out of his mouth. And when he arose against me, I caught him by his beard and smote him and slew him. Thy servant slew both the lion and the bear. And this uncircumcised Philistine shall be as one of them, seeing he hath defied the armies of the living God." David said, "Moreover, the Lord that delivered me out of the paw of the lion and out of the paw of the bear, he will deliver me out of the hand of this Philistine." And Saul said unto David, "Go, and the Lord be with thee." And Saul armed David with his armor, and he put his helmet of brass on his head, and also armed him with a coat of mail. And David girded his sword upon his armor, and he essayed to go, for he had not proved it. And David said to Saul, "I cannot go with these, for I have not proved them." And David put them off. And he took his staff in his hand and chose him five smooth stones out of the brook and put them in a shepherd's bag, which he had even in a scrip. And his sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. And the Philistine came and drew near David, and the man that bare the shield went before him. And when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth and ruddy and of a fair countenance. Philistine said to David, "I am a dog, that thou comest to me with staves." And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. And the Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I'll give thy flesh unto the fowls of the air, to the beasts of the field." Then David said to the Philistine, "Thou comest to me with a sword and with a spear and with a shield. But I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied." Yeah. Lord, as we hear these words tonight, Lord, it's easy for us to sit here tonight and imagine in our mind the courage that it took for David to move forward that day. But David had a faith that was unwavering, Lord. Lord, he believed in you, and he believed with all his heart that you would deliver him from the hand of that Philistine. Lord, if we would just get a hold of that faith tonight, that we would believe that all things are possible through our Lord Jesus Christ. Help us, God, to have more faith tonight. Help us to sling that stone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. David, if you back up and read 15 and 16, David was chosen to be king in Saul's stead. Saul was, as a matter of fact, the Bible says that God repented of himself that he had made Saul king. He regretted that because Saul turned from God with pride. And a lot of people do that. A lot of people get prideful in their walk with God, and sometimes it causes them to lose sight, as Paul puts it, of the prize before them. They get to putting prideful things, worldly things, in their paths, and collecting worldly things, and not necessarily just items, but things in their life that they, anything that they hold more valuable than the love of Jesus. And so Saul is stepping down. Saul is coming down from the throne. David, they bring him in from the shepherd out of the field, and he's anointed by Samuel. Samuel takes the horn of oil and anoints Samuel, this little boy. We don't really know how old he was at this particular time. Most scholars believe that he was around 17, 18 years old. I don't know how old he was, but I do know that the book says that Samuel anointed him with the horn of oil to be king of Israel. This is prior to where I'm at tonight. He's been anointed king, but he's still a shepherd. Matter of fact, if you really stop and think about it, any good leader in any ministry is a good shepherd. If he's doing what God has called him to do, he is a good shepherd. If he's not leading the flock to greener pastures, leading them away from sin and not preaching the truth to them, he's not being a good shepherd, folks. So David is anointed king, and he's still shepherding the sheep. And his dad calls him, Jesse. He said, son, your brothers are in battle with the Philistines over there in the valley. He said, I want you to take this bread and cheese over to them and give to the captain and see how your brothers are faring in the warfare. That was the only thing that he was supposed to do. He was supposed to just go check on his brothers. And so he gets to the battlefield, comes up over the hill, looking down in the valley where the Philistines are on one side and the Israelites are on the other side. And there's one man standing in the middle of the valley, Goliath. And he is defying the armies of the living God. He's mocking them. He's cursing them with his gods and making fun of them. And nobody, listen, nobody would set foot toward that giant. Everybody was afraid of him. They stood there trembling over one man. But this little boy, David, had killed a lion. He killed a bear. He wasn't scared of no Philistine. Because he knew, listen to this, he knew that the strength that he got to kill the lion and the bear was not his. It was God's. And so David goes and talks to somebody and says, I'm not going to let this happen. I'm going to go fight this giant. They said, you can't fight that giant. You're not big enough. That giant is too big for you. Has anybody ever told you in your life that your circumstances, the things that have surrounded your life, maybe the alcoholism, the addictions, or whatever it was your giant was, has anybody ever told you, you don't have a chance against that? You'll never come out of that. I've seen people tell that. But I always tell them, like David. You see, David, when he got ready to go face that giant, I read it to you. What did he do? He went down and he crossed that little creek that separated him and the enemy. He was brave enough to cross over alone. But on the way through that little brook, it said he stopped and he picked up 5 smooth stones. Now, there's a lot of speculation. I know I've heard it over and over about why he picked up 5 stones. Some people surmise that Goliath had 4 brothers. Now, I don't know really if he had 4 brothers or not. I know he had some brothers. But I don't really think that that was why he picked up those 5 stones. Now, some people say that those 5 stones represented grace. Number 5 is the number for grace. That doesn't seem likely, but he found grace in God's eyes when he faced Goliath. But David picked up those 5 stones, and I believe this. I believe that he got those 5 stones because he really didn't know which one of those stones was going to kill Goliath. He didn't know for sure that that first stone was going to do the job. But here's what I want you to see tonight. He got 5 stones because he wasn't going to quit. He may fail the first time, but he was going to sling another stone the second time. And if he didn't get it done the second time, he still had another stone the third time. What am I saying? I'm telling you tonight that you may fail at a lot of things in your life. You may get knocked down in life. You may get defeated in areas of your life. But don't you give up. Don't you quit. You just pick up another rock and sling another stone and say, God, you're on my side. As long as I've got you by my side, I cannot be defeated. If you've got faith like David tonight, there's nothing impossible in your life with Christ. That's the truth. So David picks up those stones, and I thought about that. You know, as I was getting ready for this youth camp coming this past week, I was there. But the week before, in my mind, I'm thinking to myself, Mickey, what are you doing? You are going up there with 45 kids, and you're 73 years old. What are you thinking? And I'm serious. I was really worried because I thought, God, I'm 73 years old. How am I going to relate to those teenage and preteen kids? How am I going to relate to them? I was facing a giant in my life. I was scared. I didn't know what to do. You ever felt like that, Troy? And I'm worried, and I thought, well, God, what am I going to do? What am I going to say? They're not going to look at that. They're just going to say, well, that's some old man talking to us. But God spoke to me. He said, Vicki, you remember David? When he picked up them 5 stones, he was ready no matter what happened. He said, you know what? He said, I'm not sending you for you. I'm not sending you to do anything spectacular. I'm sending you to just simply relay my message, my word. I'm going to do the work. I'm going to sling the stones. All you've got to do is hold the slingshot and bounce the word of God. Before was facing a giant. But after it was all said and done, God said, see, your giant wasn't so big after all, was it? And I said, no, it wasn't. You see, there's many characters in the Bible that have faced these giants. Elijah, once he was up on the hill up there with the prophets of Baal. Remember this?
Yeah.
And he was facing 450 prophets of Baal. He was facing the giant of his life. He said, God, I don't know about this deal. I don't know now. I know David killed him with one stone, but Lord, I ain't got no rocks up here. He said, what are we going to do? God said, you just tell him what I tell you to tell him. He said, just build you an altar and watch me. I'm going to do the work. It ain't about you. And so Elijah built up. But listen, Elijah built that altar, and God lifted up the altar, lifted up the water, and killed the 400 prophets of Baal. But the very next day, listen to me, that same woman, Jezebel, said, about this time tomorrow, son, you're going to die. I'm coming after you. He had just killed 450 prophets of Baal. You know what he did? He ran down under the juniper tree and said, oh, my word, God, what am I going to do? God said, pick up another rock, boy. He fed him by the ravens. He stayed under that juniper tree. But then if you'll read the rest of that story, it said Elijah ended up under a rock in the cave. And God had to go over there and said, Elijah, what are you doing over here? He said, well, Lord, I'm just defeated. I can't do anything else. I'm washed out, and there ain't nobody left in Israel but me to proclaim your word. And God says, you big dummy, I got 1,500 men that are just like you, ready to preach the word. Elijah said, oh, you do? He said, son, get you something to eat, get up, you're fixing to run. And he ran and outrun the chariots in the spirit of God. Folks, listen, Elijah faced some giants. Don't you know that the old preaching deacon that they stoned, he was facing stuff, and they just kept picking up stones and throwing them at him. But you know what he did? He looked up to heaven. He said, God, forgive them. You know, he was facing the worst giant he could. He was facing death. But yet he was giving glory to God. He was facing his giant. You're sitting here tonight and you're saying, preacher, what's that got to do with me? Every one of you sitting in this room tonight have had some giants in your life. Some serious giants that you've had to pick up another stone. You've had to gain some more strength. You've had to pray sometimes all night long for deliverance from your giant. And some of you didn't get it overnight. Some of you didn't get it in a week. Some of you didn't get it in a month. Some of you took a year or better to get deliverance from the giants that was plaguing your life and holding you down and keeping you from being what you could be for God. And that giant had you trapped in a trap and you didn't know how to get out. Ain't you glad tonight that God saw you where you were? He came to that dark place in your life and he lifted you up out of that old miry clay and set you on a solid rock. And he said, just pick up another rock and keep slinging a stone. Every time I do something good in your life, sling another stone for me. Listen, God loves to give us victory. He really does. He wants to see victory in our lives. But we live such a defeated life sometimes that God, he finds it kind of hard to work in your life because you're not hearing him. Oh, listen. Joe Don and I, we go to jail on Sunday nights. We swap up. Troy goes one night, I go another night. But there's times in there even that we face some giants. We face some obstacles that we have to overcome. And we can't say anything. We can't murmur. We can't complain. Because if we do, they'll just put us out altogether. So we just kind of abide our time and let God fight our battles for us. He makes a way where there is no way. We were down to one person, I remember, about 6 months ago. In the day, one person out of 60 coming to my church. And now, we don't have enough room in the room. We have to have church outside because people are coming and overcoming their giants. They're slinging another rock, if you will. But listen, there's one more person I'll shut up. Jesus Christ. When he died on that cross, and they put him in that tomb, they slung a rock over that tomb and rolled it shut. That was the biggest obstacle, biggest giant that Jesus had ever faced when he came to this place called earth. But he wasn't worried. He knew that rock could be slung again. And he called down some angels. And the angels came early on Sunday morning and slung that rock back off of that tomb, not so that we could go in and see that he was gone, not so he could come out, but so that we could see that he had risen from the grave. He was not there. He's not there. He's alive today. He came out of that tomb. He was in that rock for 3 days. You and I, when we face some of the things that we face in our life, it seems like it's impossible to overcome some of those things. But listen, my Bible has taught me that there's nothing impossible through God. God can do some amazing things. We went through a kind of a dry spell here just in the last 6 months, it seemed like, in our church. It seemed like God wasn't doing anything. I was telling myself, I'm preaching, but nobody's moving, nobody's getting saved, nothing is happening. I began to pray. God, move on your people. Just in the last 2 weeks, I've seen 10 or 15 people come to Christ. I've seen people being baptized. I've seen people saved all around me, everywhere. And God says, son, don't you give up. You just pick up another smooth stone. You just sling it my way, and I'll direct it, and I'll kill that giant in front of whoever it is that needs a giant slew in their life. It may be you that he's talking to tonight. It may be your life that he's holding up tonight. It may be your giant that you're facing tonight that you have feared all your life, and you don't know how to defeat it. You can't defeat it. You've got to trust Jesus to fight your battle for you. So, listen, it gets hard. It does. It's not easy. But listen to me tonight. All these people, let me tell you a story before I go. I read this story about 2 years ago. I will never forget it. There was it was a foreign country. I can't remember exactly where it was. It might have been Indonesia or somewhere. They had a major earthquake. And the kids, there was like 30-something kids in that school. And the earthquake toppled that school completely. The workers dug day and night. They dug for 2 days trying to find those kids to see if they were still alive. After 48 hours of digging, the rescue crew said, there's no hope. We're quitting for a while. We may come back and start later, but it's over. We're not searching anymore. But there was a daddy there. His little boy was in that class. With his hands and his fingers bleeding, when they started walking away, he started slinging them rocks. He started digging with all that he had. He dug and he dug and he dug. And some of the men, the rescue, stood there and said, It's too big. He can't do it. But he dug for 3 hours. And he finally rolled a stone away. And the men heard something. They heard some children down in that hole. They started tearing. They came back. The rescue workers came back, started tearing the rocks away. They cleared a hole, and every kid in that school was huddled up under a rock, safe and sound. They had ready to give up. It was too big of a giant. And they interviewed that class one by one when they got them out. And they came to this little boy. Didn't know that was his dad. They said he was, everybody else was hysterical, but this little boy was just as quiet and calm, kind of like Kyron. He was just as quiet and calm as him. And they said, son, how is it that you were facing imminent death, you and all your classmates, and they were scared to death, but you're sitting over there just singing away, not even worried? He said, sir, my daddy has taught me all my life that if I ever get in a situation where he can't find me, don't you give up. I'm coming to get you. He said, that's my daddy that was digging out. Folks, listen. Your daddy in heaven has not given up on you either.
Right.
He knows the situation you're in. He knows your calamity. He knows your giant in your life. Just keep digging. Just keep throwing another rock out of the way. Face that giant with all that you are. Come on, give me a second. I told you I wouldn't be very long. We're going to baptize Kyron in a minute. I just wanted to share that with you because that's a kind of a motto we need to hang on to. Just sling another rock. Sling another stone. When a giant faces you in your life, pick up another stone and sling it and say, in the name of Jesus, I proclaim victory in my life over this situation. And watch what God does. I promise you, you will see Him move in your life. Some of you are facing some things in your life right now. Some illnesses. Some of you are facing some big giants in your life that you don't think there's any way you can overcome. But I promise you tonight, if you'll pray and ask God to come into that situation and get on your knees and fervently pray, God will answer your prayer. I promise you. Would you stand with me tonight? I don't know who's facing that giant tonight, but if that's you, you need to be talking to Jesus tonight. As we say, what about you? Is there a giant in your life that you can't seem to shake? Is there something been holding you back from serving God? All this. Let that giant eat me alive for years. I let it control my life. I was afraid to face that giant in my life. But once God spoke to me and said, son, you ain't got nothing to be afraid of. I'm going to walk through that valley with you. I'm going to meet you right there, and I'm going to take care of you, and you're going to get victory in your life. Folks, I found the victory. The only place you're going to find it is in the person of Jesus. Would you come tonight? Are you where you need to be tonight with Jesus? Is He working in your life? Is He moving stones out of my place? Oh, that time. It seems like that time.
Jesus.
Is that you?
Jesus, I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right. He got a hold of my life. I got Jesus. I put it all on the Lord. I'm undone by the mercy of Jesus. I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored.
Thank you. This is Kyra, my buddy. I just got to believe that you're a friend of mine. I'm just proud as you can be. Kyra rides around on his bicycle a lot of times. Here around the church in the parking lot. They live right over here. He stays with his granny a lot. And he asks questions to his granny a lot, his grandpa, about salvation. He's been asking a lot. When he saw those two being baptized this morning, he had a lot of questions. He wanted to know how to be saved. He already knew. He just knew he needed to be. However, you got it now, for sure. All right. All right. Are you ready? By the authority given me by God, I baptize thee, my brother, Kyra, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Glory! dumped you again. All right. Granny, I didn't know how to spell his name for sure, so I left it blank on the card, but I filled out everything else. You feel better?
I do.
I'm knowing now that once I get to heaven, you're going to be there with me. Here's your card, baptism card. It's got the date that you baptized today. So make Granny put that up for you. Don't lose it, okay?
Any word before we go tonight? I've got three more baptisms to go, so I'm just going to stay here. Would you stand with us? Fluent dismiss.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you and we thank you and we praise you. Father, what an encouragement it is, Father, to see you moving in lives and young lives. Lord, young people that has their life ahead of them, Father, Lord, I just lift them up to you, Father, Lord. Lead, direct, and guide them, Father, Lord. Put people in their path that'll be an encouragement to them, Father. Lord, devices and tools that you can use, Father, for the upbuilding of your kingdom. Lord, I lift up our country, Father. Lord, I lift up Donald Trump to you, Father. Lord, I just ask that your mighty hand would move in a our country's circumstances, Father. Lord, that we would see you, Father, the center. Once again, Father, Lord, I just lift up our communities. I lift up our families, Father. Lord, I lift up our brothers, our sisters, our mothers, our fathers, Lord, our sons and our daughters, Father. Lord, I just pray that you move on our behalf. Thank you for what you've done here today, Father. Thank you, Lord, for what you've done this week. And Lord, go before us, Father, and prepare a way that's pleasing to you. Give us the courage and the strength, Father, to continue in that. And then we'll be found always giving you all the honor, the glory, and the praise. In your blessed name we pray, Jesus. Amen. Amen.